All right, JD, coaches, beat it. Trainers, you're out of here.
Jamie?
Yeah, Jamie's. Just excuse us for one moment, Jamie. We love Jamie. We got players only, and we are joined by Kelly Chase. What's happening, buddy? Thanks for joining
us. Hey, how's it going? Hey, how's it going, fellas? Love this segment.
Oh, well, we love having you, and obviously, question you probably get a lot and you're probably sick of, but how are you feeling? How's the health? Everybody wants to know, and because we all love supporting you. So how's everything going with you?
I'm pretty good. Yeah, pretty good. I've been lucky. I found out it was in remission here a bit ago.
Oh, awesome.
Now I just got to stick with the, routine of trying to make sure that I stay from a healthy perspective, just stay kind of out of the road and let the doctors do what they do. So I feel good about everything. And prayers and fingers crossed and all that stuff, and just try and do what I'm told.
Chase, we've been praying for you, and obviously we don't like to hear about this in our community. You're so involved and have been for a long time with the alumni in St. Louis and around the league.
Yeah.
What was the outpouring like when people heard about what was going on with you and your story?
Unbelievable. Like, first of all, the hockey world is so small, and the brotherhood of the game is unbelievable. I mean, I knew that I was blessed with having a lot of people involved in my life that I thought were great people, but honestly, the guys that's showing up and just keep coming to the hospital, and half the time I was like, kind of out of it. And I remember one time being in the hospital, and Grimmer, who you guys work with, showed up, and it was a Nash when I was a Nash. And I remember looking at him. I think I fought with Stu like 11 times, and I said, "Hey, now this is your best." I woke up and I got that ugly mug beside me. I'm like, "This is your best shot, brother. You're 0-11 right now. If you're gonna ever do it now." And he started laughing and he said, "I'm gonna kiss you right on the lips right now, and there's nothing you can do about it."
And he's trying to do that to me once too. So
I know, but on air.
On air. Yeah.
It's been great. It's been great. You see Cam Neely, talk, Kirky Muller, Osh, Twister was there every second day. I don't want to miss guys because there's so many guys that came to visit me and checked in with me every day. Doug Armstrong would come by. Alex Steen called me going out, watching games while he was in Sweden across the pond. I can't even begin to tell you. I started writing names down. I think I got to 600 people. I went in on like the 17th of November. There were 600 people on my list of text messages, and I was at December 1, and I've been at it since then. So I'm like, I don't know how to thank everybody, but the outpouring of hockey community, there's nothing like that brotherhood.
You mentioned Tony Twist, and I got to hear this story from the horse's mouth. Tell me about this story, how he wanted to break you out of the hospital.
Well, it keeps getting bigger and better, but I did have a little bit of a meltdown of sorts, where I had made a commitment with my doctor that if I did my bit and I'd taken a Peloton in there, and I'm getting a lot of grief from my former teammates because I had a Peloton in there. I was doing sit-ups, push-ups, and I was walking between 7 and 10 miles a day in the hospital. And they were like, "Man, you never worked out that hard when you played. If you'd have done that when you played, you'd have played for 3 more years." And they're probably right, but I was in there. My doctor was like, "Oh, you'll be laying under that thing day 3. And I told him, I'm like, "We'll see." So after I had rode that bike between 30 and 45 minutes a day for 24 days, I had told my doctor, "But if I get to my numbers, can I get out of here?" And everybody had told me, "You're going to be in here for Christmas." And I'm thinking in my mind, just like when you're hurt as a player, they tell you you're out 6 weeks, you're thinking, "I'll be back in 4. When I'm thinking, how do I get out of this place for Christmas? And I was supposed to be there till January 5th, I believe. And I got my numbers. They came back. Everything was good. My doctor's not showing up. He's not around. He's at a seminar. And I just was in the shower. And I think from the chemo fog or whatever they call it, I just emotionally was exhausted. And I just said, like, "I need to get out of here." I'd been in the hospital 30 some days. So I had tears running down my face and was hyperventilating. I got out of the shower and I made the sensible decision of calling my good friend Twister. If you know Twister at all, when Ben Affleck in The Town says to Remy about, hey, I'm going to ask you to do something, we're never going to talk about this again, and we're going to hurt some people, and his friend answers, whose car are we taking?
Nice.
That's Twister to a T. So I asked him to come and get me out of there, and he wanted to make sure I was okay, first of all, and then his second response was, okay, I got one question. And I said, what's that? He said, are you hooked up to anything? And I said, no. He said, I'll be there in 20 minutes. So I kind of came to a little bit and told him I didn't think it was the best idea, and maybe he should come the next day. Once the doctors had seen me, I'd be good till 4 o'clock. And he showed up in the morning. He owns St. Louis Windshield and Repair, and a service truck had been parked in emergency with some flashers on and some pylons around it, and happened to be his. And it had a hoist on it for my Peloton. And he had two hockey bags for all my stuff. And he just basically said, hey, what do you need me to do? And I packed up all the hockey bags and I said, the doctor isn't here yet. And he said, look, there's my truck over there. I'm going to take your stuff out of here. You go down the elevator with the employee card, down through the basement, up the escalator, into my truck, and get my truck when he comes. I said, all right. So we decide we're going to have this breakout. And he comes back and he's like, what are you doing? And I said, the doctor hasn't been here yet. My doctor's not here yet. He goes, and just then my doctor, my actual doctor, not the fellowship, my doctor walked in and he's like, hey guys, what's up? I go, well, look who came back. Look who came back when the work's done. I was supposed to be out of here days ago. I'm still in here and I'm giving it to my doctor pretty good. And he's giving it back to me going, relax. I was out of sound. I'm like, relax. You told me I'd be out of here. And he goes, all right. And he looks over at Twister and he goes, how you doing? Huh? And he introduces himself, Ramsey Abood. He goes, Tony. And he sits there with that muscle look and his beanie on. And he goes, you a hockey player, Tony? Twister goes, nope. he looks at me, he goes, I'm going to discharge you today. You good with that? And I said, yeah, I'm good with it, but are you? And he goes, yeah, I am. And he goes, you good with it, Tony? And Twister goes, oh, I knew he was leaving today. I didn't know how we were getting this damn Peloton out of here without anybody seeing me. This has got me with a sheet over this Peloton, like nobody's noticed this thing went up, rolling down the hallway in front of everybody. And so Twister just told the dog. And then when he said, what are you guys doing? Then he realized, he goes, what's the matter with you hockey players? He goes, you don't have a flu, you got leukemia. He goes, you don't just leave. Where's your stuff? I said, he took my stuff. What do you mean he took your stuff? And he was rattled. Anyways, he goes, you stay in that bed till two more doctors see you today. You're not going anywhere till I'll discharge you this afternoon. So Twister at that point grabbed the bike and he just turned to me. He said, I'll see you at home, buddy. He goes, you don't need me here anymore. So he just walked out the door with my bike and everything was at home when I got home, man. And he was breaking me out. So he's a 3 a.m. guy and there's not many of them.
Oh, that's unbelievable. I'll never get tired of that story.
That's
for
Twister right there.
Switching gears to the event Friday. I'm so excited to be able to go to this. If you want to sort of talk about it and give all the details of the Puck Cancer alumni game that we have going on Friday.
Sure. Well, first of all, thank you for being a part of it. And I know that, you know, you've heard them say, hey, you've got leukemia.
Yeah.
And you think you're a big, strong guy and, you know, you're invincible. And then you know, it makes you look at things certainly a little differently. And I didn't want to be the only guy that represented cancer or this disease. And I know you're coming, and I know Darren Kimball has now come out and talked about his struggles that he's had 3.5 years of leukemia. And Troy Murray will be there. And, of course, our good friend Tony Granato. And for lack of a better term, I did not want to be the Make-A-Wish kid at this thing. I wanted it to kind of be all of us that represent kind of the NHL. So the support group kept growing and growing. And of course, we got some actors involved. DB Sweeney will not be coming now because he He took a job in Bulgaria. I guess if you need work, you got to go to Bulgaria. That's what happened. But Dave Coulier, you know, I started calling around to some of my buddies that play hockey, just rec hockey, Dirk Bentley and Trevor Rosen from Old Dominion, who played junior in the USHL and college and, you know, heck of a guy. And then I called Garth and I said, you know, I was hoping that he would get a guitar for us and sign. He goes, what do you need? What exactly do you need? Whatever you need. And I said, I need you to play goal on this one team. He goes, anything but that, buddy. I'll do whatever you need. But I'm not. So he then Jason Graham from Teammates for Kids, who I've been a part of for a long time, called me and said, hey, you know, Garth's going to come and he'll do a meet and greet and meet with everybody that you want to meet with. So we have this huge VIP event going on. And the sponsors like the Med Spa you see behind us, which I'm a part of, and you know, the people at First Form and Medea and Car Shield, and these people just started, all of a sudden you just seen this great on my buddy Mike Rayner. These guys just started making donations and it grew into something really cool where Sean Payton's now coming in, coach of the Broncos, who's my buddy. He's coming in. He's actually been taking lessons, guys. 8 sessions of ice he's been taking trying to play in this thing. I said, you want to screw up your summer of golf, play 30 minutes of hockey with us, and somebody for sure is going to run into you, you know, knock you on your ass. And then, you know, then, of course, you'll know what it's like, you know, the difference between running around with cleats on. And so there's a great grouping of guys, an NHL group, a St. Louis Blues alumni group. Our chapter president's meeting for our alumni association is on at the same time. So, you know, we have 80 guys. I looked at the list today. I think there's 80 former players or celebrities going to be at the event. So I'm pretty grateful for the support. And I can honestly say I know I didn't get the support because just of me, because I've certainly thrown your name around and I've thrown Tony's name around and Darren Kimball, and the support you get is unbelievable. I mean, we talked about the brotherhood of hockey, certainly, but guys genuinely care about you, and guys that I was a complete ass to on the ice that have reached out to me. And I'd look at my phone 3 times going, this is my buddy's playing a trick on me, because there's no way this guy reached out to me the way I was, you know, on the ice. And then I would reach out and they'd be like, hey man, I'm checking in on you. And you're like, wow. Like, so you really get a sense of how close and communal this group is. And so I'm grateful and thankful to you, Brian, for saying that you'll participate as well. And the NHL Network, of course, stepping on board. They've never been as good since I left, but it's nice of them to get on board with this.
Chaser, I got to say, like, we didn't cross paths when we played. Thank God for that.
Yeah, for you look pretty, so that's good. Yeah. You're taking that away.
Well, so I can work on TV.
Yeah.
But the amount that you've done for others is, I think, the reason why you've had such an outpouring and people willing to help you. I don't know anyone. Like, I had a bad bounce as well, but my recovery, my treatment was nothing compared to what you've had to go through. And then on top of that, going through that and organizing and putting this together with the intention of not, I'm going to use your words here, not building another parking garage, but having it go to real research and development.
Right.
Like, what you've been able to do throughout your whole life. This isn't just a I got sick, aha moment. You've done this for a number of years, taking care of players on the alumni and guys that have retired or guys that have lost their way. That's why you've gotten such an awesome response. And that's why I'm honored that I got the invite, because this is something that you can be a part of, a good thing. And it's no surprise to anybody that you've had the success you've had. It's still incredible, though, that you've done it with, you know, having the battle of your life. So it's just like, again, I wanted to say that. It's not a question. I just wanted everyone to know, kind of having talked to you a few times and what you're kind of going through, how impressive that is.
And Chaser, I just wanted to piggyback off that, just because hearing your story and talking with Boiler and hearing the support you get from guys that you played against that probably didn't like you, but it just shows me, it's my first year out of the league, and I've realized how important being out of the league, that support system is, of guys that you've played with and battled against, and how important is the Alumni Association, and how there is such an effort by guys like you. And I've seen when the Alumni Association is done the right way, it's absolutely incredible. And I've seen teams miss on it. But how important is it for the Alumni Association to continue to grow and continue growing that support system for guys that are playing and struggling outside of the game?
What's funny you say that, because, you know, Glenn Healy's our director, I'm Paul Cavallini, and Adam Graves are on our executive board. And then we have, you know, we have Koff and Mark Messier, and Pronger's been a part of it, and Guy Carboneau and Trotsky. And I'm missing a whole bunch of guys, and Adam Burrish and Mayers. And so you got these guys that all of a sudden got involved. We have a lot of guys that didn't even know there was a league alumni association. I think when you see all of the guys that are in trouble, because Jason, I think one of the things you realize when you leave the game is you don't miss the game as much as you miss the guys. But you've had structure your whole life. So as a 15-year-old, or, you know, I've been lucky because I was always the guy that thought I was going to be working by the end of the year in some factory or on the farm rather than still making the team. So every year I was preparing to not play another year, and how I was getting, I was just lucky that that's how it worked out for me with businesses and stuff. But a lot of my teammates that I saw have success on the ice didn't have so much success off the ice. And what happens is the structure that you had as a kid, and especially you see these kids that go through the development program, especially they do a great job of the development program and all of that, but they start getting on a plane and being told what to eat when they're 15 and 14 years old. And then they get on a bus, and then they tell them when they can sleep and when they can eat and when they have to practice and when they have to train. And so these kids playing junior out west or whatever they're doing, they've had this structure in their life. And then they play pro, or they play in college, and then they play pro. And the same thing happens. And then you get to the NHL. And obviously, as players, we're the last to know that we're no good anymore. And we all of a sudden become these guys that are looking for something. When you guys see this alumni locker room that we have in St. Louis, it's a place for guys. And in St. Louis, like Bruce Affleck, my son Will, have done an unbelievable job of putting this thing together. There's just so many people who have done such a great job of putting this thing together, and I get credit for it. But you guys know this. You walk into hospitals, and you go through them, and you see these sick kids, and you feel bad, but you're a mile wide and an inch deep. You never really dig in until, like Boiler says, you get a bad bounce. And then what happens is you walk down the hallway and you look in the room and go, holy cow, that guy doesn't look good. He's sick. I don't know. And you realize that you're two rooms down and you're in the same spot, but it's different because your whole time you've been helping people. So now you have to dig down and find a way. Hey, what am I going to do? And I think Tony Granato put it best. He's like, now we have a larger platform to help more people, not just young hockey players, but people with cancer and people that are going through a tough time in their life. So while I appreciate the accolades, that's nice of you guys. There's a whole team of people around that make the community, that make you go, okay, I don't mind participating in that, not only because of what I've gone through, but also because I think too many times we don't realize that 5 minutes of our time is worth more than 5 minutes of, or 5,000 of our dollars.
That's unreal.
That's such well put too. It's just a credit to everybody that's helping you and yourself. I mean, listen, you don't want to take the accolades, but we're going to give it to you. But everybody surrounding this whole event, I mean, it's incredible. Brian going to, like, it's what needs to happen. And it's, I love to see alumni associations on top of groups of people coming together, because we can enact so much change and help so many people. And it just requires us all getting together and putting our heads together. So, I mean, kudos to you for sure. And you.
Thanks,
fella.
Chaser, we got a couple of videos, if you don't mind. This is a part of our segment called What Were You Thinking? So it's going to be a look back on some things that you've been involved in, and you're just going
to have to put the pink glasses on.
Yeah. Throw the cheaters on, and then you'll be able to just kind of walk us through what's going on in certain situations that we've seen. Give the viewers a little peek into your life. Okay, here's the first one.
Oh, this is Keenan sending Twister out to tell me to calm down. You know what?
That's one way to
do
it.
If Twist's jersey would have stayed on, he would have lost that fight. You know, I don't know if he knows that. Well, he does know that. Him and I are pretty tight. If that jersey stays on when he goes down there, he's going to get it. But he had got into a fight with Mark Jansen, and I was running around, and Murray Barron, I think, and I crossed paths, and Keenan had traded me. So Keenan was at that point where he decided he was going to send Twister out to tell me to stop running around. And I told Twister, who was living in my house with his son, with his son and daughter and wife were living in my house. Okay. And so Twister is renting my house, and he says to me, what do you want to do? Let's just get this over with. I apologize for the noise outside here, guys. I do have people working at the thing.
That's okay.
And I ended up getting into a fight with him. And I said, let's just get over with. He goes, are you serious? And the funny thing is we had these people that were so concerned about how much, because we played junior together, we played the minors together, we played the NHL together, and they were so concerned with the fact that that Twist and I had fought and we were out for beers after the game. Really one of my only friends that I think that I fought that I really was close to at the time of playing in the NHL.
That's your 3 a.m. guy.
That's
shows
my 3
you how
a.m.
much you care about
now.
Your teammates.
Yeah, right. Fighting at 3.
Awesome. All right, what do we got next? That was sweet. Oh, yes.
Oh, God.
Okay, fella.
Shrek. Battle of the Blades. That's actually Kyoko Ina, who's, like, been unbelievable. It's amazing how tough these figure skaters were. You go and, you know, you always wanted the figure skaters off the ice so you could play hockey until you realize that how tough they were and how much work they put into being good at what they do. And so I had Kyoko as a partner in Battle of the Blades. They talked me into doing it because they wanted to raise money to build a children's hospital in Saskatchewan. And we didn't have a children's hospital in the province, which we now have. And the Garth Brooks Foundation, which is teammates for kids in that, build a child life zone in there. And that's how I got sucked into doing this show. And I can tell you, when I first, they never sent me the videos of the previous year until I agreed and signed the contract. I never would have signed it if I saw those guys the year before, because that was the hardest thing I've ever done in my life. And I have never had anxiety like I had the very first show when they said, we're going live across Canada in 30 seconds. I can tell you, I was as close to throwing up as I've ever been doing in any game. I'd have rather fought Chicago Stadium 6 times than have that happen.
Can you imagine?
I got asked to do it, and I said, no chance.
They didn't ask me. I
was like, there's no way. There's no possible chance in hell I was doing that. So credit to you.
You'd be great. Honestly, it's one of the best things I've ever done in my life that I've accomplished. And I will tell you that they don't put you in bad spots, but you are so, first of all, I'm used to not being a good skater, but falling down, you would fall down in a day 25 times, maybe sometime, because you literally toe pick and that's it. Right. So, it was miserable, that part of it, but I got to tell you, it was something that I'm glad that I did. And I would tell anybody, if you ever get asked and they're doing it again, Sandra Besick and the crew that put that thing on did an unbelievable job. I tell you guys, if you get asked to do it, do it.
Be dangerous.
I'm not doing it again. I can tell you that. But I'll tell you.
I can barely lift my arm over my head now.
See,
I don't know how you did
doing
that
out there.
Oh yeah,
like twinkle toes.
All right, we got one more. We got one. Oh,
how do you get that? Oh, that's off my.
Jason Pucks.
That's Perry Turnbull. He used to play in the NHL. And I'd flown back for an alumni event, and I had an infection in my tooth back here, which they still haven't fixed, which is years ago. And my face was swollen up, my eye was swollen shut. And I said to Perry, I wish I could just pull this thing out. He said, you want me to pull it out? I'll pull it out. And I said, would you pull it out? And he goes, yeah, I'll pull it out. So he went and got some needle nose pliers out of the back room of the rink. And he came in the alumni room and he goes, come on. I took me in the bathroom and he yanked out one of my molars. And I mean, the pressure out of my face just was gone. And I was like, man, it hurt for like 10 seconds. And as soon as that hole was out of there and everything was come out of my face, I was like, oh my God, that feels good. And guys are looking at us. And it was a fantasy hockey camp. And there was guys in the room that had paid to sit in the locker room, in the alumni locker room. And there was like 5 of them going, I'm not going out on the ice with this guy's a lunatic. There is no way going on the ice with this lunatic. But anyways, Perry Turnbull pulled out my molar because I had infection in my face.
That's Wolf the Dennis Stanton right there from the Mighty Ducks too.
Incredible. That was awesome. Hockey job.
That's unreal. Chaser, listen, thank you so much for your time, buddy.
Like we got the puck cancer pucks.
Oh, there you go.
Oh, that's awesome.
How about it? You like it? So we left room boiler for your autograph.
Perfect.
We're going to have some of them and the QR codes, and we'll have auctions going on during the game for jerseys, sticks, all kinds of stuff going on that you guys are going to help us promote.
Right.
And then we'll also be making sure that we do a live auction while we're there too for a few of the guys that are not the hockey player athletes, but more the entertainers and have some guitars and stuff like that. So it'll be fun. And I really appreciate you guys having me on. Again, great segment, you guys.
Oh, it was
you guys
awesome. Do and that online auction to raise funds opens April 4th, correct?
Yep. Yes.
And that'll and be out there.
Game's Friday. Open, yeah, there it is. That.
Awesome, yep. Man. Chaser. I'll be talking to you soon, buddy. Thank you so much again for coming on.
Thank you.
I'll see you Friday.
I want to see the difference between Hull being mic'd up and what Sean Payton sounds mic'd up. So when you guys start figuring out how you can tape all of that and cut and paste, that'll be great. Brett Hull,
it'll be awesome. There might be a lot left on the cutting room floor.
Yeah, some ears bleeding a little bit there with them. Hey, have a great one. Keep the fight. Keep going. That's awesome. And everybody go check out Puck Cancer Charity Game.